Kirk.
Oh, Maple Bay, you sounded like quite the nice seaside town. But now that we know something dark is afoot, or at least potentially afoot, my outlook on you has changed. In the last video, we basically covered things A to Z in the hidden cult ending within Dream Daddy. Your character wakes up bound inside a dark dungeon. Joseph approaches you in dark robes with a sinister vibe. He drops some serious bizarre knowledge bombs on you that make you question everything. Mary helps you escape, you find out you really never escaped, and then Joseph tries to kill you. But that's not all. Mary does Joseph dirty by stabbing him with a knife you got from Robert. Those weird, creepy children end up actually being demons, and you all flee from Joseph only to wake up in your room and hear that the yacht you were on actually sank. Now, there's obviously a lot more going on, like the introduction of a new dad. So if you haven't watched part one of this Daddy Dilemma, I highly recommend getting up to speed on that video first. With everything included in the cult ending, we have a lot to work with here. There's a possibility that you waking up in your house is still a part of the dream. But what makes me not think this is true is the addition of a new dad that you have never met before. He could be a figment of your imagination, but what throws a wrench into things is that the gallery looks like it can fit an eighth dad photo. And we only have seven. Of course, trying to list out all seven dads in any order other than single file will always yield an outlier position. But I believe Saul Graves is the eighth dateable dad of the game, and perhaps in future DLC he could have a role in things. But what parts are dreams and what parts are reality? If everything is a dream, then this nightmare you're experiencing could be due to the guilt you have felt about coming between Mary and Joseph in the relationship. You always found Joseph attractive, and before you found out the details of his marriage, you still had no quarrels inserting yourself into opportune dating situations. It isn't just your fault though, because he obviously fed into this too. This would make someone feel guilty, especially if their actions could split apart a family with children. In order for you to have Robert's knife in your dream, that means you had to have encountered Robert on the dock prior to going to Joseph's yacht. If you date Robert twice, but ultimately decide on Joseph, you will encounter him there. He warns you that Joseph is not who he seems to be, and that he would put a knife in your back in a second. He mentions the Dover ghost again as well, and then eventually storms off. Remember, you do get a knife from Robert on his second date, which Mary uses to stab Joseph with in the back. Just like Robert mentioned in his conversation. Also, just because you found out about Mary and Joseph's fight on the yacht, doesn't mean your dad's son's conscious before that could have influenced your drunken dream that night. Heck, in the middle of writing this script, I went to bed and dreamt about magical beings fighting inside of a church. And it's probably due to all the research and time I spent on this script the day before. All that is collateral for your dreams. If your dad Sona found Joseph's kids to be scary and they reminded him of some of his favorite creepy movies, why wouldn't his mind manifest them as demons? Our dreams are often twisted forms of our own reality, and sometimes your fears manifest themselves in the oddest ways. On top of that, how many dreams have you had where you can't run fast enough or ever reach your destination? The hallway in this dungeon seems to be exactly that. Joseph being demonic himself could be symbolic of his struggle with his family, and that he's battling his own inner demons at all times. He's supposed to be a pillar and role model for the community, but his desires are destroying that for him. The outer shell of his family seems to be jolly and pristine, but really, the family itself is in shambles. But writing this off all as dream theory is sort of a cheap cop-out. So let's tackle the other angle, because there's a lot of evidence in the game that points to this being reality and not a dream. The endless tunnel and dark dungeon may be due to demonic and mental alteration, but the reason they came about is due to Joseph indeed being someone with a dark connection. There's a lot of subtle references to things too, like Joseph reading a book on tying knots, to his twins cutting up a stuffed animal in the middle of the forest. The dolls in his house even show clear signs of dismemberment. Going back to the yacht thing though, Robert has already gone through the same exact thing you're going through. When he runs into you on the dock, he angrily says, "And I suppose two friends just spend the night out on a private yacht together, being buds, chatting about friendship." Is that what two friends do? At this point, your character has no idea he will be on the boat all night long. This means that this was all part of Joseph's plan, and Robert has done the same thing already that you're about to do. The running out of gas, the radio situation, how long has Joseph been doing this with all the dads in the area? The demons in the dungeon also have black eyes. But your character doesn't remember Robert saying they have black eyes. When he has to recall the story of the Dover ghost on the fly, he says they have red eyes. In his mind, that is how he remembers what they look like. So if a dream is drawing influence from his consciousness, and it was utilizing all phrases and fears his mind remembered, the demonic kids should have had red eyes, not black. In regards to Joseph and Robert hooking up when you're talking on the yacht, your avatar states, "Things happen, Joseph, and I think you of all people deserve a little forgiveness." Joseph then responds, "That means more than you'll ever know." Now, this could be referring to Joseph's role as a youth minister, but I think it has double meaning. You'll never know how much it means because you couldn't possibly understand what he actually goes through on a daily basis. It is beyond your comprehension, like he states in the dungeon. This may be derived from Robert saying this same line while talking about the Dover Ghost, but I think parts of his Dover Ghost story are true. He surely talked up the story, but it isn't all fiction. He knows it exists because he has seen it, and that is why even when he is in a non-joking mood at the pier, he still brings up the Dover Ghost in a situation where he is 0% sarcastic. When you mention pentagrams and Jimmy Buffett to Joseph on the boat, he goes from laughing to serious, and then soon after resumes his smiling composure. As a youth minister, I make pacts with neither the devil nor island jammers. Lastly, there's a guy who tells Mary he thinks he can exorcise her demons, if that's what she's looking for. Again, this is just a dude being sleazy, but the double meaning is certainly there given her creepy kids.
However, there's still one thing we need to cover, and that is the symbol of the cult, or at least what we assume is the cultist symbol. The symbol itself is a small plus sign with a circle around it, with six spokes or tendrils resonating from the circle. Now, looking at this immediately makes you think of a ton of different things. So let's go over this one by one. Starting off, let's look at it as if it were from above. We know our home is on a cul-de-sac with other fathers, and that Mary states that Joseph more than likely lived in your house before you, or some other father did that was sacrificed. My immediate thought was that this looked like the cul-de-sac from above, with a plus sign marking where the star was on the map. Each of these tendrils reached out to a house. I quickly scrapped this idea because although it is neat, we have 8 houses total and only 6 spokes. It still seemed like a pretty good match given the shape of the cul-de-sac though, and the star marked in the center. It could also be the wheel of a ship, I suppose, too.
Let's take a closer look at the cult symbol again though. One of the things I noticed right away were its defining features, and how it parallels to other symbols in history. Circle-based symbols in general tend to carry a sense of unity and infiniteness to them. A circle symbol with a dot or another marking in the middle has typically been used to represent the sun in many different cultures. The outer spokes of the symbol could very well be the rays of the sun, and this has also been repeated in history. There was also a figure known as the Wheel God, whose symbol mirrored this. They were named Terranus, and they were a thunder/sky/sun god who had a sun cult that actually sacrificed humans. I think that is a bit of a stretch, but it is worth noting. Going back to Dream Daddy though, why the symbol of the sun, assuming that is what this symbol is? We don't know if there are other cultists besides Joseph, so perhaps this symbol is just dear to him. However, this symbol isn't only found within the dungeon. It's in other places in the game as well. For starters, Joseph's living room has a symbol on his clock. It is a bit hard to notice at first because Joseph blocks your view from it when he's in the room, but it is certainly there. On top of that, it is also hidden behind the lighthouse in one of the shirt choices at the beginning of the game. This one in particular is very much in line with the sun symbol because it overlays the sun itself. It is worth noting that the map on the boat looks like it may have it as well, but it could also be the icon for cardinal directions. The last place we can find it is tattooed on Robert's hand, which is the most bizarre place of all. Why would Robert have this symbol on his hand? And more so, what does it mean? When you ask Robert about this tattoo when you first meet him, you get a cold response as he claims, "It's a reminder." Now, this statement completely changes everything when you think about it. Robert can hook up with you right after the bar visit, but him hooking up with you isn't regrettable. It was all in good fun. And if you ask Joseph about Robert, it seems like the two had a one-night stand and then things subsided. I think this is a bold lie, and really what Robert was trying to warn us about. You see, Robert and Joseph didn't just hook up. I believe they were in a long-term hidden relationship. In the photo on the yacht, it's apparent because even back then, Robert was wearing Joseph's sweater. This tattoo of the symbol is a testament of that relationship, to the bond they shared. Your character isn't the first one to visit the Margarita Zone, despite what it seems. The clues are even within Jimmy Buffett's song itself. In the song Margaritaville, Jimmy sings about how he got a tattoo while staying all season within this area. His tattoo isn't a sun, but I think the sun is symbolic here. The sun is the peace and serenity of what Margaritaville stands for, and escape. Wasting away in Margaritaville,
with not a care in the world while relaxing under the sun. Trapped in a relationship that Joseph simply held for the sake of the town, his only escape was through Robert. And Robert eventually became you. Now, this analysis leans more towards the dream side of things again, though. Because with this analysis, it just shows that Joseph is a two-faced individual that really only cares about his own desires and manipulates people to achieve them. Mary even states she feels like a ghost. She haunts the hallowed halls of Jim's and Kim's, waiting for her beloved to return from sea. She says this jokingly, but Mary is obviously an emotionally drained character, and the bar for her is her own escape from her husband. Her beloved is out at sea often, on his yacht, being intimate with people who are not her. In seclusion, Joseph can say whatever he wants to you to get you closer to what he wants, and then he simply rebounds once you're back on land. He leaves you high and dry, wondering what went wrong. This is what is so regretful to Robert, and why this son is a grim reminder. As Mary says, you're just a sailor, and you're aboard Captain Joseph's ship. But this really puts us in a spot where the outcome of this dream versus not dream thing is a coin flip. And we still have Saul, who is someone we've never seen before, yet seems to be present in our world. I think making up a father in the dream doesn't make a whole lot of sense. If this is a dream based on all your fears and feelings, but the ending of the cult scene isn't a dream, then Saul has to be discussing actual real events in regards to what you saw down there. The yacht could have sank, but that means his wife still mysteriously disappeared. Given all of this, I strongly believe that Saul is a character that will be introduced in the future. Overall, it's possible this cult scene was scrapped because it painted religious bisexual men in a bad light. But ultimately, I know Saul was a dateable choice at one point because the code for the game has different emotions for him. When he's chatting with you, Saul slash flirty neutral is an image that is called upon, meaning there's interest in your character. This same exact situation happened in the game Night in the Woods, where a scene was left in the game after being scrapped, but the inclusion of the scene drove people insane because it changed the meaning behind everything. Games obviously evolve over time, and the story does indeed change. However, given the official response that was given to Kotaku in regards to the hidden scene being, mysterious, it's apparent that the creators behind Dream Daddy have watched the same process roll out for every game before theirs. Due to all the dialogue clues within the game itself, I personally believe we aren't fully dealing with a dream here. Do I believe Joseph and his kids are probably demonic? No. I mean, that'd be one hell of a twist, but I think all of this is symbolism for Joseph's character. He will prey on men because he has a lust he cannot satisfy, and he will always default to this manipulative behavior. This bizarre dreamscape is a subtle way of hinting that he is truly two-faced, and that not as all as it seems.
I mean, demons would be pretty nifty too. Not gonna lie, I'm always up for a good horror story. Oh, and one last thing. I totally thought the cult symbol was also symbolic for light coming from the lighthouse as well. You know, the small little cross being the actual light in a lighthouse, and the outer circle and rays are all the light that is shining out and stuff. Did anyone else find that lighthouse super mysterious? Like a psychic beacon of unfathomable power, shining on Mary's map with six beams. And that shirt, I'm telling you, the lighthouse is a place for answers. They'll call me crazy, but they'll all see. They will all see. But now that I dumped that on all of you, I'd of course love to hear your thoughts. Do you think the cult symbol is symbolic for Joseph's escape from reality? Do you think it is actually just a symbol for the sun? Or do you believe it is truly demonic? And last, if Stranger Things Detective Saul is released in the DLC later, how do you think it will affect the story? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. And with that, thanks for tuning in to this Deranged Dream Daddy Dissection Part 2. If you'd like to join me on my YouTube voyage and continue to ship your favorite fatherly figures, then the subscribe button is just where you're looking for. Thanks for watching, guys and gals, and until my next video, cheers. Perhaps someday we'll get an answer to all this stuff, but in the meantime, here's some other videos to get your brain juices flowing. There's a slew of other theories on this channel too, so regardless, I hope you enjoy.